In the faith, why is it that those that were running before are now standing? Why is it that those that were running before are now sitting and no longer concerned about the things of God? I will show us a few things right now about the causes of fear and the discouragement that hinders courageous running. That hinders courageous running. The causes of fear and discouragement. Some people, when you look at them, it is sin and disobedience unto God. Sin and disobedience. Let's look at Genesis chapter 3, verse 10. We see the case of Adam there. And then in verse 10, and he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was the next word? I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself. Transgression brings fear. Sin brings fear. The same person you have been free to go to before, now you cannot go freely anymore because of fear. What brought that fear? Sin brought the fear. The person you have been free to call and communicate with easily, now you can't do that because something wrong had taken place. The Lord himself will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Fear and disobedience is one thing. Another thing is disappointment. You have an expectation, and those expectations are not met, then you are discouraged. And then the fear of, will I succeed? Will I make it? Is there. And then you want to begin to cut corners. You will not cut corners in Jesus' name. At other times, some people are deceived. And because of deception, they are deterred. They are turned away from the path of life, the path of righteousness, the path of holiness, the path of uprightness. And then you see yourself, you want to get married, and the enemy is deceiving you. Well, in this church, look around, how many men are in the church? 1, 2, 3. And how many women are in the church? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 3 men to 10 women. And this church, they don't allow polygamy. What is my chance of getting married? I think I need to begin to look outward. It doesn't work that way. God will give you your own spouse.
Amen.
If it means for God to import the man for you, for your sake, amen, your own will come. How wonderful will it be if your husband is imported? Somebody say amen.
Amen.
That means it's brand new. It's different from all the common ones. Why don't you say, Lord, I don't care who is here and who is not here. I want the best from you, and you get the best from God in Jesus' name. But you know, the devil want to deceive you and tell you, well, why don't you begin to compromise, dress like this, dress like that, change your style, walk like this, so that the people out there will know that, yeah, even though you go to deeper life, but your body is there, depending about your mind is out there in Sodom. You will not be a bastard in Jesus' name. Stand your ground in the Lord. Stay with us. Don't allow yourself to be deceived. Or you are in a business and the enemy is telling you, well, in America, even though they say no bribing, but they know the way they do it, and then how they get the business. You know how you cut corner. You know how you give this gift and give that gift. And you know you are bribing and you are corrupting yourself. Man may not see, man may not know, you are being deceived. If you die in that situation, you will miss heaven, no matter what you have done in the past. Deceit will bring fear. And then, many a times, a lot of us, when we have done things that are wrong, falling into the deceit of the enemy, and then we go to God in prayer. You know what I have discovered in life? When you are not standing right with God, you cannot stand right in prayer. When you are not standing right with God, you cannot speak with authority and with confidence. Instead of you going in prayer and taking authority, you go in prayer and pleading and apologizing every day of your life. You make yourself a servant of sin. a servant of sin, the Lord will deliver in Jesus' name. So deceit is another thing. The other another time is disease. Some people, because of sickness, because of infirmity, that will not go on time. They think, well, I need to seek for help somewhere else. I knew of somebody that was coming to our church, and then it turned out she was sick, and they prayed and nothing seemed to have happened. And later on, before I knew it, I was told they took her to somewhere, and with further inquiry, it was an hapless place they took her to. To go and get some care. If you get to a point in your life that your God cannot do it, it's a terrible thing. And yet, God will allow some things in life to bring out the things that are on the inside of you. If you're a proud person, God will allow some things to bring that pride out. If you're a worldly person, God will allow some things to bring that that out. If you're not stable with the Lord, God will allow some things to really test and prove you. To cut a long story short, she died before the shrine.
Ah, Jesus.
She died and went to hellfire. I knew of another man that gave his life to Christ. And this one, I actually worked with him. And it wasn't of deeper life, but eventually came to deeper life. Everything turned around by the grace of God. Eventually, he fell sick. And then people were suggesting to him, go here and go there. And he said, no, I am a child of God. My God is able. Even if God chooses not to heal me now, I will not compromise at this last stage of my life. Eventually he died and he went to glory, and I rejoice in the Lord. I pray that your last laugh will not be a disaster in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So, disease. And it can be any kind of disease. You know, at other times, it is division in the church. And you don't know, some things happen. You don't understand that sometimes the wind blows. And the storm rages. And when the wind is blowing the forest, all the trees, both the tall and the short one, everything blows like this, blows like this. Now understand. The wind is blowing, not because of the healthy trees, but because of the unhealthy one. So that all the unhealthy branches and the limbs, and all the unhealthy leaves and that are dry can fall off. You will not fall off in Jesus' name. And then you say, if there can be a division in a church like ours that preaches holiness, there is no division anywhere. I hope you understand. I'm just telling you what happens in different places. Maybe there might have been in the past. I don't know of any right now. So I'm just preaching. And then you now say, well, in a church like this, if there could be this kind of division, I don't think I want to stay. Hey, listen, except you remain in the ark, you will not be saved. If that can happen in a church that preaches holiness, righteousness, and purity, what then do you think they're going to get out there? What do you think you will get out there? And that's why sometimes some people that think I can stand alone, I can stand by myself, they bolt out of the church. When they get out there and then they test it out, they realize that what they thought is bad here is better, mightier than what is out there. Those of them that have the fear of God, those of them that are determined for heaven, those of them that are humble and really want to make it to the end, they put ego aside, they put aside what man will say, they come back to the church and they say, we are back. You will be back. In your mind, you are gone. I declare today the Holy Ghost will bring you back in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And physically, you are gone. You only came to visit. You have tested out there. You have seen what is going on. I pray the power of God will bring you back into the fold in Jesus' name.
Amen.
The enemy allows some things to happen so that those that are not free, that are not serious, can be cut off. You will not be cut off in Jesus' name. At all that times, the problem that makes some people to have fear. here and then quit the faith is their unmet desire, desires of men. And other times, you see some people, it is the sustained, unrelenting battle they are facing. They forgot that the Christian life is a battle. Ephesians chapter 6, looking at it from verse 10, the Bible tells us, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against, help me here, flesh and blood, but against what? Principalities, two, powers, three, rulers of darkness of this world, and four, spiritual wickedness, where? In high places. They forget that we are in a battle. That from the very day you gave your life to Christ, your God enlisted in that battle. And they forgot that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. Every stronghold of the enemy in your life are crumbling in Jesus' name. Amen. 1 Samuel chapter 21. 1 Samuel chapter 21. I'm looking at it from verse 9. 1 Samuel 21, verse 9. There in verse 9, the Bible says, and the priest said, the sword of Goliath the Philistine, whom thou slewest in the valley of Elah, behold, it is here, wrapped in a cloth, behind the ephod. If thou will take that, take it, for there is no other save that here. And David said, there is none like that, give it unto me. Give it unto me. And David arose and fled that day. For, what's the next word? The fear of Saul. The fear of Saul. Fear made people to run away. And went into Achish, the king of Gath. And the servants of Achish said unto him, is not this David the king of the land? The king of the land, the king of the land. Pay attention here. Put your hand there. He ran away from his place of appointment. He ran away from his place of blessing. And even though he has not been ordained, he has been anointed, but not yet ordained, even the enemies can't know he's an ordained king already. Listen to this. The hand of God is upon you. The power of God is upon you. Stand your ground and don't run in Jesus' name. Did they not say one to another of him in dancing, saying, Saul has slain his thousands and David his 10,000? And David laid up these words where? In his hand, and was so afraid of Achish, the king of God. Now, what drove him away from Israel? Fear. Now, what is happening before Achish, where he ran into? Fear within, fear without. Fear paralyzes. You'll not be paralyzed. Verse 13. And he changed, what's the next word? His behavior. His behavior. Is that not the problem with many of us? Because of fear, we can't stand our ground. We can't declare that we are Christian. We change our conduct, our behavior, our attitude in compromise. He changed behavior before them and found himself mad in their hands and scribbled on the doors of the gate and let his speech fall down upon his beard. That is what fear does. Now God will deliver you from fear in Jesus' name. 1 Kings chapter 19. 1 Kings chapter 19. And look at it from verse 1. And Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, and whither how he has slain all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger unto Elijah, saying, so let the gods do to me, and much also, if I make not thy life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time. And when he saw that, he arose and went for his life and came to Beersheba, which belonged to Judah, and left his servants there. Who are we talking about here? Elijah. Verse 4. But he himself went in his journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a juniper tree, and he requested for himself that he might. You will not die.
Amen.
You will not die.
Amen.
Lift up your right hand right now and say, in the name of Jesus,
I shall not
die, but live to declare the great work of the Lord. In the name of Jesus, the Lord will keep you. The Lord will preserve you. You know, thank you. Put out your hands. Elijah quit the ministry before his time. You will not quit before your time in Jesus' name. Christian calling and ministerial calling, don't back with unlimited power from above, and supported by the brethren and the local church. Experiences have shown us that power from above is not sufficient for some people. And because of fear, they run from their place of refuge, they run from their place of protection, and they run to the camp of the enemy. They will not run to the camp of the enemy in Jesus' name. We are told in the book of Timothy, 1 Timothy, I look at chapter 1, verse 7. There the Bible says that 1 Timothy chapter 1, 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7. It says, desiring to be teachers of the law, understanding neither what they say or where they are found. I think I'm getting the wrong thing. I'm trying to get the place where the Bible says that God has not given unto us the spirit of fear. Amen. Amen. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7. Thank you. For God has not given us the spirit of fear. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
But of power and of love and of a sound mind. That is your portion, that is my portion, in Jesus' name. God is not the author of fear. Anytime you're afraid of making it, that is the enemy coming your way. Get rid of the enemy and you will make it in Jesus' name. Exodus chapter 14, verse 10. Exodus chapter 14. We look at the 10th verse there. It says, and when Pharaoh drew nigh, the children of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them, and they were so afraid. And the children of Israel cried out unto the Lord. Unto the Lord. Now, two things happen here. When they saw the enemy, they were afraid. But something good happened. What did they do? They cried unto the Lord. Don't run away from the presence of the Lord. Remain in the Lord. No matter how you're feeling, call upon the Lord. Sometimes it is human. But never allow fear to overwhelm you, to overtake you. Peter was in the boat. He saw Jesus walking on the water. And then he said, Jesus, if that be you, bid me to come. He had the courage at that time. And then Peter, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of his faith, with that faith, he stepped out. And you know, Peter was a fisherman. Peter knew much more than that, that the water is not a solid rock. You step into it, you drown. But then he kept looking unto Jesus. Jesus, is that you looking unto Jesus? And then I could imagine Peter bringing out the first leg out of the boat and then trying to put in the water, and then as he touches the water, it was solid under him. Is it real? Is it real? Is it real? On Christ a solid rock I stand. All other ground are sinking sand. But pay attention. After Peter brought the second leg out, he was standing, he was walking. Is it real? And then Peter suddenly realized, I am on top of the water. Supposing it is just an ice that formed, and everything gave way, what becomes of me? The moment Peter began to think of that, in fear, what happened to Peter? He began to sink. You will not sink in Jesus' name. But then Peter did something good. He did something good. He did not fall onto the other apostles because he knew they cannot help. Sometimes they are going to someone that cannot help you. What did he do? He cried unto the Lord, and the Lord saved him. He will save you. You know, at another time, I'm not saying that just peradventure, something happened and fear came taking me, not because of sin, but because of the wind of life, because of the storm of life that wants to make you give up your faith. You call on God, you cry unto God. Christ was in the boat with the disciples. And then in Mark chapter 4, and then as they were traveling, then the wind, the storm, understand, in this life, the wind will blow. The storm will rain, but they will not overtake you. And then Jesus was resting. And as the wind was blowing and the storm raging, it was beating into the boat. And water was coming in. Now the people there understand they were fishermen. They did not jump out of the boat. They remained there. What did they do? They cried to the Lord, Master, Master, carest thou not that we perish? Many a times you have issue, you are running to unbelievers. Many a times you have a problem, you are running back to your family. Call upon the Lord, they will make a way for you. And then Jesus shows up, he rebuked the wind, he rebuked the storm, and everything became calm. In your life, peace be still. In your family, peace be still. On your job, peace be still. That problem in your body, I speak right now, peace be still in Jesus' name. None of all those will take you away from the Lord. None of others will shift your faith and focus away from the King of Glory in Jesus' name. All these things causes a problem. You know, sometimes it's because we overestimate the enemy. That's the reason for fear. They will do this, they will do that. You forgot that you are a man and a woman of authority. That the Bible says that you shall declare a thing, decree a thing, and it shall be established unto you. No matter how you want things to be in life, you are a king. Decree it and it will come to pass. The problem is we overestimate the power of the enemy and we underestimate ourselves. And then we have forgotten that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal but mighty through God. Through God. You know, at other times some people is self-confidence. Self-confidence. Tell me somebody in the Bible that self-confidence almost destroyed him. Peter. Instead of self confidence, put your confidence in the Lord. Amen. I said, put it in the Lord, and it will keep you to the end in Jesus' name. At other times, it is the statistics of people that are falling. When you look at this one, that has happened, that one, that has happened, and then you look at some people you met in the church, you met in the faith, and the way they are living their life, even though they talk about, they preach about, but they are not living the life. And then yourself say, I don't think this thing is real. For as long as you're in this tabernacle, you can't live above sin. It's a lie. You can live above sin. Tell somebody, you can live above sin. I say, tell somebody, you can live above sin. And say to somebody, you are now saying to somebody, I will live above sin. If you will not, I will. By the grace of God, I will. With the help of God, I will. By the power of God, I will. I will make it to the end in Jesus' name. I have the good news for you. I said I have the good news for you.
Amen.
I have some brothers and sisters, fathers and mothers that run this race immediately. And every time I go to, you think overseer doesn't go to challenge? You think pastor doesn't go to challenge? You think superintendent doesn't go to challenge? Everybody does. Everybody does. But whenever it happens, those of us that are standing, this is what we do. I will lift up my eyes unto the hills. From whence cometh my help? My help cometh from God, the maker of heaven and earth. And then we look at people like Peter. Peter made it, I will make it. Paul the apostle made it, I will make it. Moses, that initially with fear, because of fear, ran away from Egypt to the wilderness. Moses eventually made it. Look at Elijah, we read about a few minutes ago, that ran away from a woman. Who is supposed to you? A woman? A Jezebel? What to that Jezebel? Don't run from that Jezebel. Because God has given you power and authority over that Jezebel. Decree it will come to pass in Jesus' name. Who is that individual? And Ahab wanting to take your life that he took the life of Naboth? No, if God be for us. No, I said if God be for us. Nobody can be against you. You will not die.
Amen.
You will not die.
Amen.
You will not die.
Amen.
Moses was told by God, go back to Pharaoh. Go back to Pharaoh. And he went back to Pharaoh. And he finished his ministry. You will finish your ministry.
Amen.
Joshua chapter 5 is starting. Causes of fearlessness. Joshua chapter 5. We're looking at the 13th verse there. There the Bible says, verse 13. And it came to pass when Joshua was by Jericho that he lifted up his eyes and looked, and behold, there stood a man over against him with his sword drawn in his hand. And Joshua went unto him and said unto him, art thou for us or for our adversary? Verse 14. And he said, nay. Nay. But as the captain of the host of the Lord, I am come. And Joshua fell on his face to the earth and did worship and said unto him, what saith thou, my Lord, unto his servant? And the captain of the Lord's host said unto Joshua, loose thy shoe from off thy foot, for the place whereon thou standest is what?
Holy.
Is holy. And Joshua did so. Pay attention here, look up there. Joshua thought he was alone, living Israel. Joshua did not know or realize that there is an invisible personality working with him. Joshua thought maybe it was just setting up the stone and doing this and that that made them to cross the Red Sea. Joshua did not realize that there is somebody that the sea saw, that Jordan saw, that made things to happen. Very good that we are coming back to this. Open your Bible to the book of Psalm. The book of Psalm. I believe it's 114. Psalm 114. I wait for you to get there. Psalm 114. If you are there, say amen.
Amen.
If you are not yet there, say wait for me. Alright, we are waiting. Amen, but hurry up. Because this race must be with speed, with focus and determination. Praise the Lord. Now if you are there, say amen.
Amen.
Alright, Psalm 114. When Israel went out of Egypt, the house of Jacob from a people of strange language, Judah was his sanctuary, and Israel his dominion. The sea saw it and fled. Jordan was driven back. The mountains keep like rams, and the little beast like lamb. What ail thee, O thou sea that thou fleddest, thou Jordan that thou was driven back? Ye mountains that ye speak. sheep like ram, and ye little ears like lamb. Everybody, verse 7, tremble, thou air, at the presence of the Lord, at the presence of the God of Jacob. Praise the Lord. This is the mystery. This is the mystery. Let's back up a little bit to Moses. Before Red Sea, the people cried unto Moses, next time you are going to cry, don't cry to someone that cannot help you. They cried unto Moses, and Moses looked at himself and said, I am helpless, I am powerless without God. And then Moses did what? He did the right. What did he do? He cried unto the Lord. And God said, Moses, why are you disturbing me? And God is telling somebody here, why are you disturbing me? I gave you the power, I gave you the authority. I said you will decree a thing and shall be established unto you. I told you that wheresoever the soul of the foot shall tread upon shall be given you as a possession. I told you that these signs will follow them that believe. In my name, you will cast out devils. You will speak with new tongues. If you lay hands upon the sea, they will recover. Why are you disturbing me? Why are you disturbing me? Why are you disturbing me? And God said to Moses, lift up your rod. He lifted it up. God then said, point it to the water. He did, and what happened? It parted. It parted. What happened? That is what the psalmist is referring to here. That's what he's referring to here. He said, when Israel went out of Egypt, the house of Jacob, from a people of strange language, Judah was his sanctuary, and Israel his dominion. The sea saw it and fled. Every sea before you sleep. You know what happened? Is the glory of God showed up. And as soon when Moses lifted up the rod and then pointed to the water, the glory of God showed up all of a sudden. And what happened immediately, without any wasting of time, the sea parted hither and thither. And then Israel went through. In the name of Jesus, you are going through. By the power of the Lord, you are going through. Every obstacle on your way, every obstruction on your path, the Lord will clear them up in Jesus' name. Now it was the time of Joshua. And Joshua now got to the bank of Jordan. And God told Joshua, if you're going to cross this Jordan, if you're going to cross this problem, on what condition? Sanctify yourself. Holiness, purity, righteousness. If you're going to overcome the enemy of your life, if you're going to be able to run the race, effectively successful to the end, holiness, purity, righteousness, uprightness, sanctify your side, and then upon the elders. That is why we expect people in the church that are elders in the church and leaders in the church to live an example. Let each one be a stone, and it's a stone of memorial. There are ways you live your life, there are sacrifices you make in life that will be a memorial for others to follow, that will help them to run the race effectively to the end. And then, as they were going, they got there right now, going by the instruction of the Lord, Jordan saw it, and then, what did he do? Fled. That's what the Bible says, and Jordan was driven back. Now, this same Joshua, of course, they knew when they left Egypt, the pillar of cloud was with them. The pillar of fire was with them. But at this point in time, the pillar is no more. And Joshua thought, now that the pillar is no more, we need to strengthen our hands. No, you will not fight in this battle. Did you hear what I just said? You will not fight in this battle. Whose battle is it? It's a lost battle. It's a lost battle. He will wait for you in Jesus' name. Yeah. That's why you should be courageous, that you will make it to the end. You make it to the end. And so, at this time, Joshua was there. And then while he was there, the Lord showed up. He saw a man all over him. And then Cornelius said, "What? Are you for us or you are for our enemy, for our adversary?" And he said, "I am come as the captain of the host of the Lord." Who is this captain of the host of the Lord? Jesus. Somebody say Jesus.
Jesus.
Somebody say Jesus.
Jesus.
All through the time they left Egypt, he was there with them. The rock in the wilderness that was strong, that brought out water. Who was the rock?
Jesus.
He was there. He was there. And the Lord will continue to be with us in Jesus' name. Tell somebody, God is with you.
God is with you.
I didn't get that one.
God is with you.
I said, tell that person, God is with you.
God is with you.
Amen. And now tell somebody confidently, God is with me.
God is with me.
If God be for us, there is nothing the enemy can do to you. Don't be afraid. That's why many people are falling, because they are not sure of the companionship of the Lord. Now, another thing, see from this passage that we read. The angel, the captain, that came like an angel, which is Christ himself, he said, take off your shoe. Because the ground where you are is what? It's a holy ground. Why is it? Because the Lord himself is there. When we met with Moses in the wilderness, and then the bush was burning, the voice came, Moses, take off your shoe, because the ground where you are is what? Holy ground. This is where I am going. God in person was coming that time. Right now, where is God? I said, this is just a good test for you now. Where is God right now? Inside of you, inside of you. That means anywhere I go is a holy ground. Anywhere I enter becomes holy, because I am pregnant of God. I am carrying God. Everywhere I go, victory is following. In the name of Jesus. That is why every day of your life must be a holy life, a righteous life. You don't want to grieve the spirit of the Lord. You don't want to wait until you come to church. You know why this church is a holy place? It's because there are holy people here, carrying the holy God on the inside of them. Who is carrying God right here? Because it tells us, I will live in them. Amen. And that is why you are victorious. That is why you are victorious, and the Lord will keep you to the end in Jesus' name. Moses made it. Elijah made it. Elijah still walked with God despite what happened. That God sent angels to Elijah to come and transport him home with chariots of fire. You know why it was chariots of fire? So that nothing around will be able to hinder the flow of the moon. They are angels of fire. Angels of fire, and I'm here to let you know that the angels of the Lord, they encamp round about them that fear the Lord. You are not alone. I said you are not alone. The Lord will keep you. The Lord will preserve you. That is why over here, when we say, this is sin, that is sin, stay away from me. When you read from the word of God, stay away from me, because you want the presence of God. You want the companionship of the Holy Spirit in your life. You want the guidance of the Holy God of heaven. You want someone that will fight the battle for you. Moses did not have to do anything to cross the Red Sea. God did it. Joshua crossed Jordan. God did it. Even the battle of Jericho, all they did was just march around, march around, march around, march around. And eventually, God, in his power, sent a visible army inside the city. Amen?
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 Amen.
This is what happened. Let me tell you. There is a combination of physical and invisible things that happened. As they were exactly that wall, is an indication, amen, of God collapsing the wall. And the final shout that they were told to shout on the seventh day, and the last march, that shout is a shout of jubilation. It's a shout of victory. And then what is our shout of victory today? Oh, you are not sure. That's why you are here. I said, what's our shout of victory today?
Will you shout and let me hear you? Will you shout and let me hear you? Will you shout and let me hear you? Hallelujah! 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 Amen!
It is well. It is well. I feel like I'm almost in heaven already. Because those of you under the sound of my voice, together we are making it. The three Hebrews made it. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Despite the circumstances surrounding them, you will make it. Daniel made it, you will make it. Look at even Elisha. Elisha, even after Elisha was dead, the power of God was still with him. You know, the little children, when we are in the children's class, we tell them, show me your power, and they do like this. You remember? Children teacher, you remember? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And I don't know, because our power is Christ Jesus, I don't know how to tell you to demonstrate your power. Amen? But all I can tell you to do is to just chant that name.
Jesus!
I can hear somebody.
Jesus!
At the mention of the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Is Lord. Listen, right there where you are, I can tell you I don't have enough time, that I'm just getting to a place and some strange personalities will be there. How do I know? Because of what happened, and somebody not talking, not preaching, not praying, and somebody just suddenly begin to scream and shout. Until they take the person out before we are okay. And so, God is there with you. Amen?
Amen.
And anywhere you get to, if there is anything contrary, the power of God will knock them out in Jesus' name. Even after the death of Elisha, the carcasses of Elisha, the rotting bone of Elijah, the power of God that was there when he was alive was there with him in the grave. They threw a dead man into that graveyard of Elijah. As soon as the body touched the bone of Elijah, what happened to the person? He woke up. Life is coming back to you. In the name of Jesus. Very quickly, I get to the final part, combating the forces of fear. Combating the forces of fear. Isaiah chapter 35 verse 4. Isaiah chapter 35 verse 4. It says, say to them that have a fearful heart, be strong, fear not. Behold, your God will come.
Amen.
And when he comes, he will come with vengeance. Even God with a recompense, he will come and save you. All those that have afflicted you shall be afflicted.
Amen.
All those that have tormented you shall be tormented.
Amen.
All those that have troubled you, the Lord will trouble them in Jesus' name.
Amen.
The Lord is with you. The Lord will walk with you. The Lord will strengthen you. The Lord will keep you in the name of Jesus. Now, the Bible says, he will come with vengeance. Let me show you something from the Bible. Are you ready?
Yes.
Are you ready?
Yes.
Well, I just want to show you very what will become of your enemy. That's why you should not be afraid of running this race, of running it in righteousness and purity and holiness. You know, the Bible says that the righteous shall be as bold as lion. Bold as lion. All that God needs to see is just righteousness and holiness that defies you. Defies you. Open your Bible to the book of Isaiah. Isaiah. Because we have been told in Isaiah 35, 4 that your God will come with vengeance, with recompense. He will come to save you. When he comes to save you, understand the enemy has taken grip of you. Now God is coming to save you. For him to save you, what is going to happen to your enemy? Are you there? Chapter 29. Look at verse 6. Look at the verse 6. Now, please, for goodness sake, don't read this one to your fellow brother. Don't read it to your fellow sister. Amen? This is meant for the enemy of your soul. Praise the Lord. Are you there?
Isaiah 29, if I were you, I would mark this in my Bible. Okay, shall we look at it? It says, thou shalt be visited of the Lord of hosts. With what?
Honor.
With what?
Honor.
To who?
Enemy.
I said to who?
Enemy.
Your enemy. He said, your enemy, my enemy, our enemy, the enemy of the Lord, shall be visited of the Lord of hosts with thunder, and with earthquake, and with great noise, and with storm, and with tempest, and the flame of the burning. Your enemies are before. Your enemies are before. All that are incensed against you shall be destroyed in the name of Jesus. So, if you are going to overcome this enemy, Isaiah chapter 41, verse 10, it says, fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. Tell somebody next to you, fear not. I love my brother, he said it with smile and with conviction. I said, tell somebody, fear not. Amen.
Amen.
Because God will help you. No matter what you are going to, God will help you. It says, fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. Yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. Verse 11. It says, behold. Behold. Who is God talking to him? I think it's me. He says, behold, all they that were incensed against thee shall be ashamed and confounded. They shall be as nothing. And they that strive with thee shall perish. That is the word of the Lord. For you to be able to make it to the end in Jesus' name. You know, God is saying to me to tell you through his word, that all those things that have made you to be rejecting, fearful, panicking, God is saying that the time has come.
Amen.
You will even look for them, you will not find them.
Amen.
Look at the next verse. Look at the next verse. What is the next verse? Tell me. You know, please let me challenge you here. You know, sometimes I hear some people that are not even holiness church like us, they say they have a prayer line. And then you log into that prayer line and you see thousands of people there. But you know, we that says we are the children of God and we are men and women of the world, when we call for prayer, we don't see us. We don't see us. From now on, we will see you. We need prayer. That is why over here, and you have the announcement earlier on, every blessed month, we have prayer and fasting in this church. And that's why things are working right for us. And things will work right for you in Jesus' name. Every blessed month, we have night vigil in this church. In this church. And we've been doing this for years and years and years. By the grace of God. Every blessed